welcome to the High Energy Seminar. And today our first speaker is Dr. Rakesh Yadav. Rakesh got his bachelor and master degree in 2011 from Indian Institute of Technology. And in 2012, he moved to Max Planck to study for solar system research. And he did his PhD in computational astrophysics to study how stars and planets generate their magnetic fields. And he got his PhD in 2015 and joined the CSA. Now he's a postdoc here and studied the stellar activity theoretic model.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Today I'll share with you some of the work which I've been doing at CFA for the last now almost 2 years now. And the work basically involves trying to understand the activity of M stars using different theoretical tools and maybe try to have some kind of prediction for some future missions. And the first question you may ask is that, okay, why do we care about M stars? And the very short question is that Proxima Centauri. I guess all of you know that a few months back, a team found or discovered that there is an Earth-like planet orbiting around this star. And Proxima Centauri is an M star, which is, they call fully convective M stars, and they don't have any radiative cores, so they're quite exotic. And after reading it, probably every one of you must have thought that, okay, let's go to Proxima Centauri. And indeed, our prayers were heard. And people from Breakthrough Initiative, they announced that they're actually planning a mission to Proxima Centauri. And they plan to send a collection of microsatellites to look at it and take some pretty pictures and just to see what's out there. So let's take a look at the Proxima Centauri system. Proxima Centauri is about 10% of the solar mass. It's a pretty small star. In terms of size, it's actually pretty similar to the Jupiter size. And the planet itself is about 0.1 AU, so a factor of 10 closer to its parent star. And the fact that the planet and the stars, they are so close to each other, it makes many of us who study these kind of things that maybe the system, it's basically a Sun-Earth kind of system, but on steroids. The interaction is going to be much, much stronger in this case because these are so close to each other. Now, we don't know. We can expect or we can have some kind of an idea, but to really understand what it actually might be, we need to do some really detailed modeling of this system. And detailed modeling really involves trying to understand what the planet around this star might be experiencing. In the solar system, we can actually model our own space weather to a pretty good extent because we have a good understanding of, or at least we can predict or we can observe what the sun is doing every hour or every day. So we can include that in our modeling effort and predict what the Earth faces and what kind of coronal mass ejections might hit us and might go away from us, and what kind of radiation Earth receives. All of these factors affect how life has developed in the past on Earth and how it may develop in the future. So we need this kind of information to really understand this kind of star planet systems. But the problem here is that this requires a rather elaborate pipeline of information. First of all, you need the detailed magnetic field information of the star, and also the morphological information, like what's the vector of the magnetic field? How is it organized on the surface of the star? You plug that information, and then you have some kind of a model for the activity of the star, like what's the X-ray, what's the UV, what's the flare rate of the star? And then you take that into account, and then you have some prediction for radiation and some stellar wind, which might hit the planet and might interact with the planetary atmosphere. And then you basically describe what might be the space weather of this planet orbiting Proxima Centauri. The problem here is that you need really detailed information of the magnetic field if you only want to have a detailed model of the space weather of this system. So what do we know about the magnetic field of Proxima Centauri? Not much. We know that it's about 600 Gauss on an average. The RMS is basically a surface averaged mean of the magnetic field. And we infer this information from something called Zeeman broadening. And you just look at the broadening of the line which is coming from the star, and you model it, and you say it's about 600 Gauss. So it's something. It's about 10 times larger than what we what Sun produces on an average scale. So we know something, but not really that much. The stumbling block here, which is stopping us from inferring a lot of information about Proxima Centauri's magnetic field, is that it's slowly rotating. And that's really, that doesn't allow us to apply some of the techniques which people have used to infer magnetic fields of other stars. So Proxima Centauri is about 80 days rotation period, and these kind of techniques, they model the Doppler shift of the spectral lines, and with this kind of rotation period, it's not really that useful. You can't apply those techniques to these kind of stars. So what do we do? Now, here we have to really resort to really detailed theoretical models for these stars. We don't have good enough information to model the space weather around this in this system, so we need to go for something called the dynamo studies, which generate the magnetic fields self-consistently given some basic ingredients. And then you can, if you have that information, then you can plug it into some kind of a Proxima Centauri-like system, and then you can model the space weather of this planet and understand how what it feels right now and what it might have felt in the past. So we need to go to the dynamo models, because these other ways are somewhat shaky. But the problem is that dynamo models or dynamo theoreticians, they can run really wild, including myself, if there are no constraints to stop us. So you really need tight constraints. Otherwise, in principle, these are theoretical simulations. We can do many experiments as we like. So we need some tight constraints if you want it to be relevant for these kind of systems. So we have to take some sort of a detour in terms of how we train our models. And the thing is that when Proxima Centauri-like stars, they are much younger, they rotate faster. So in this diagram, on the x-axis is basically a proxy for rotation period. Here you have stars which are about 10 days rotation period, and Proxima is here, which is about 80 days. The mean magnetic flux, when you look at these kind of a really young Proxima Centauri, let's call them that. So it's about 2 kilogauss or 2 or 3 kilogauss. It's pretty strong. So it increases if you go when stars are younger. So they produce a lot of magnetic fields. The good thing here is that we can apply those techniques which can give us some idea about the morphological features of the magnetic fields of these stars. For example, there is this star called V374 Pegasus. It's about half a day rotation period. And in this case, we can apply techniques to really infer the morphological features of the magnetic field. It's not really a detailed map as we have access to in the case of Sun, but it's something. So you can see that these kind of stars, very often, they generate kind of like a dipolar structure on a very large scale. So the magnetic field is basically dipole dominated, and it's about 2 kilogauss. Now keep in mind that the solar dipolar magnetic field is probably 10 gauss at its best days. So it's really, really strong. So it's not really equivalent to what we have on the Sun. It might look equivalent qualitatively, but quantitatively it's really different. So in this quadrant, when the Proxima Centauri was very young, we have the average magnetic field, and we have some kind of a morphological input. So now we can try to model this here and try to train our dynamo models. And so the basic strategy, what I will do, what I will describe here is that first you match the observation for younger, faster rotating Proxima Centauri-like stars. You then move on to decreasing the rotation period of these stars. And then you try to develop a dynamo model for Proxima Centauri. You use that information for the dynamo model, and you drive the stellar activity of this star. And then you probably can simulate the space weather of Proxima Centauri b, which is the Earth-like planet orbiting in very close to the star. However, this is a pretty involved exercise, and we have been at it for the last 1.5 years. So far, we have managed to carry out this step, and I think we are in a good stage to move on to the next. So in this talk, I'll just stick to the first step. How do we train our model so that they can be applied to the Proxima Centauri later on? When you're modeling a star, including its dynamo and its activity, in principle, you're supposed to do it like that. You model the high-density convection zone where the dynamo operates. You can you also model the low-density corona, which is wrapping around it. So in that case, you can model everything self-consistently. But this is a really challenging task in terms of computation. We can't do this, at least in the current landscape. We don't have the computing power to do it. So we improvise. We decouple the problem. We first study only the dynamo problem of the star by just looking at the physics happening in the convection zone of the star. Once the dynamo simulation has some solution, you can use that solution to supply some data to the corona modeling simulations, which model only the outermost part of the star. And then you can try to infer pseudo self-consistently the case for this kind of stars. So the dynamo model, I'm not going to show a lot of nasty equations. So just every dynamo model for any star has some basic ingredients. So you need a rotating sphere, which is obvious. These kind of models are really global models. They don't they're not modeling just some part of the star, but they try to model the entire star. You have to have some kind of compressible thermal convection because that's the way, that's the generator of all the electrical currents which might produce some kind of dynamo. And you start off the system with a seed magnetic field, which is just random. And the system might, depending on the conditions, it might sustain a dynamo in the long run. So just to give you an idea, without going into too many details about what the dynamo does and how it does it, let me just show you some spatial and some temporal things which happen in these kind of simulations. Here, which is, this simulation is basically showing you a time span of about 10 stellar rotations. And this this model rotates about 10 days, about that rotation period. So it's about 100 days in real time. On the left hand, you have the northern and southern views of the star, and you can see that we have thermal convection. I mean, that's what you see here. You have this red blobs which come out, and the red narrow blue lines, which are basically plasma going in. So it's basically a boiling system. And this Reynolds number, which is translates to about a few meter per second flows. So the plasma is going like that. It's it has some kind of differential rotation if you're familiar with it, but if you're not, then it doesn't matter. In this panel, we have the corresponding magnetic field which comes out from this simulation. First of all, you will notice that on the northern and the southern poles, you have opposite polarity of the magnetic field. So yellow and the blue regions are opposite polarity, north and south, for the magnetic field. So you see that although we started the system with a really random seed magnetic field, it has produced a magnetic field, or rather it has self-organized the magnetic field on very large scales where you basically have some sort of a dipole component. So the dynamo is working here because it can sustain these kind of magnetic field on very large scales. On top of that, we have very small scale fluctuations, which are basically because of the turbulence happening in here. This kind of boiling motions, it doesn't want the system to be in a pure dipole state. So it fractures it, breaks it up, and then recycles it to very small scales. And you can see that these small scales are really kind of like solar active regions, because on Sun, one of the active regions has northern and southern polarities very close by. All over the surface of this simulation, you see all these localized features, which are basically solar active regions. But of course, they are hundreds of them rather than a couple of them which we see on the surface of the Sun. So this is really hyped up system. And the magnetic fields are in the range of plus minus 10 kilogauss, so it's really, really strong magnetic fields. So we wanted to have some understanding of how does it compare with the actual observations. We got the dynamo. This is a snapshot from the earlier simulation. Again, here is the magnetic fields. So we have some magnetic fields, and how do we know if it's comparing well with the observations? So what we did is that we assumed that we have some kind of a star, some artificial star, and we apply the same technique which people use to observe these, observe actual stars. And the technique is called Zeeman Doppler imaging. Basically, you construct a synthetic spectra depending on the sensitivity of the magnetic field lines, depending on the field strength and whatever point you have. And then you reconstruct from that what might be the magnetic field. Of course, this technique only applies to the linocyte component of the magnetic field. And because you have small-scale cancellation effects, so you have this plus and northern and southern magnetic field, which cancels out each other's. It looks at the polarization of the lines coming out, and you have some local noise which cancels each other's effect. So you only look at large scales. So at the end of the day, when you apply this technique and see what happens, you see that overall we get some kind of a dipole. And it's kind of obvious from here. If you squint your eyes, it's basically like a dipole sitting up here. And in this exercise, you recover about 20% of the magnetic field which we put into the system. And this number is actually expected from observations, and people expect that when you apply this kind of smoothing technique, or when you only look at the large-scale component, you're of course missing out the small-scale magnetic flux, which is not visible. So the same thing happens here, is that we recover about 20% of the magnetic field. And it's sort of like a dipole. And it compares very well if you just smooth the magnetic field by hand, and you just look at what the, only the large-scale component. And you see that they're pretty similar. Of course, it tends to be more axisymmetric, and this is some of the drawbacks for these techniques. So this is this kind of map, which if I go back to, it looks very similar to the observational map which I showed you, which is basically like a dipole aligned with the rotation, which is a long vertical line here. And the value is about 2 kilogauss, and if I come back to that figure, it's somewhat larger, but it's still in the same ballpark. In the observation map which we constructed, is very similar to what people actually see. So, okay, we have some reasonably good-looking model. So what we can do is that we can now try to model the activity of the star. We have some reasonable confidence that, okay, the magnetic field looks pretty similar to what we actually see, and we can now try to model the activity of the star. And the activity, I'll focus on, concerns only the corona of the star. So I'm not concerned about the chromosphere and all those regions, only the corona of the star. And the corona is basically a magnetically dominated region. The densities are so small of the plasma that it's only mostly the Lorentz forces which are controlling the plasma flows. And if you ignore all the flickery stuff happening and the waves, flares happening on the star, more or less, the morphology of the loops stay pretty stable for some time. Again, this is, of course, a sped-up movie. If you look at the sun, it's not that dynamic. So it's pretty stable for a reasonable amount of time. So the basic model which people have been using in this community is that any loop on a star, any magnetic loop, is the collection of magnetic field lines. And the loop is, the base of the loops is anchored to the photosphere, which is basically bubbling around. So you have basically shaking of the magnetic field lines every time. And the shaking of the magnetic field lines generates alpha waves in this coronal loop, so-called coronal loop. And these waves interact with each other, they generate alpha wave turbulence, and that turbulence leads to dissipation of the energy stored in these magnetic field lines. And that basically leads to enough heating of the plasma entrapped in this loop that they reach pretty high temperatures to millions of kelvins. But of course, this model only applies to non-flaring component of the corona. Corona, of course, has a flaring and a non-flaring component, called, so-called the quiescent component. So we can't model flares with this model. We can only model the non-flaring part. So let's see. Let's move ahead and apply that. These kind of models, which we want to apply to our model, to our simulations, they have been benchmarked with actual observations of the sun. Given we have, there are many, many theories which say that given some topology, morphology and some strength of the magnetic field, how much heating you can expect. And if we have that prescription, you just apply that information to the magnetograms coming from the sun, and then you see how much heating we get and how much X-ray emission we get. And this model, they try to reproduce at least the large-scale features on the sun. And you can see that this active region here, it's captured to some extent, and you have this heating up here and these lobes coming up. And they all capture to reasonably good extent in this kind of models. So, this model we can apply as long as we have the magnetic field. This is just the magnetogram which I showed you earlier from my simulation, where you have some kind of a dipolar structure. This is now a flattened projection, latitude and longitude. And you see that we just input this magnetogram into the corona model and see what happens. This is what finally comes out from these kind of simulations. On the surface here, I'm just showing you the magnetic field strength, which is about plus minus 400 Gauss. And the temperature is shown by color on these magnetic field lines. So you see that the corona of the star is basically consists of loops which are going from one pole to the another one. Now, this is really unprecedented because on sun, if I go back, you only have these tiny active regions where you have some of the loops which are bright in X-rays. But here, the coronal loops are basically going from one to the other, one end to the other. That's because this simulation has magnetic fields, which is really, really strong, of the order of kilogauss. And it's present all over the surface. On the sun, one of the active days, you might have some active region which is like one of these, but that's about it. But here, there are hundreds of them, and they all make a corona, which is really robust and extends to very large distances from the surface of the star. And the temperature in the largest loop is actually the hottest one, which is, goes to about 6.5 million Kelvin. And the smaller loops, which are close to the surface, they are relatively cool. Of course, they are million Kelvin, but they are relatively cooler. Now we have the temperature information. We know the particle density around the star. We can now construct the X-ray emission for this case. This is what the final product looks like. At the end of the day, we get these kind of emission maps for these simulations. You see that one of the first striking things you see that the entire corona of the star is shining. If I go back to the case of the sun, we have one of these regions which are relatively bright. But in this case, the entire corona is shining from pole to pole. Of course, you do have some kind of morphological features, which are because magnetic field is not completely uniform. It has some deviations. But overall, the entire corona is shining. And the although you can't see the loops here, but the loops are in principle very large. But the most of the emission is coming from close to the surface because the density of the plasma is somewhat higher here. Okay, so we looked at what this star, or so-called star, might look like if we were to observe it by some telescope. The X-ray flux which comes out from this as a function of the phase of the star is pretty simple. As I told you, there's not much structure in the corona. So the corresponding X-ray light curve is pretty smooth profile. And the values which we get is about 10 to 28 ergs per second. And these values are actually consistent with the observations of these very young Proxima Centauri-like stars. They're consistent, but they're smaller than what we see. Now, that is expected. As I told you, we don't model the flaring component of this star. We only model the quiescent corona. And because these stars are so active, they are producing flare every minute. And that constitutes a lot of the X-ray flux which we see from this star. So if you add that kind of if you add the flare component, then this will be entirely consistent with what we actually see in the observation. So in the future, we might impose some flaring activity which is guided by the actual observation to have some idea about what these stars are doing. So all of this so far is inconsistent, and this was one of the first steps to move towards actually modeling the Proxima Centauri. And I'll just end and summarize what our state of knowledge so far. We think Proxima Centauri, when it was really young, must have looked like that. Of course, it wouldn't show you all the field lines, but you can see that when these stars are very young, they produce a lot of magnetic fields, and they are more often, they are very often dipole dominated. So you can see that the overall there's a dipole structure here. The magnetic field is very, very strong, about plus minus 8 kilogauss on this map here. And you see that the loops are all over. All these loops are capable of sustaining really, really bright corona, or really, really strong heating of the corona, which is around the star. So all of this loop lead to a very, very bright, shiny corona for these kind of stars. And because of the fact that we have these small active regions, which are basically scattered all over the place, hundreds of them, and all of them have plus north and south magnetic fields, they basically lead to a lot of flare activity, and that's actually what we see. We're not modeling it in our simulation, but in principle, it should lead to a lot of flare activity, and that's what we see. And this is the first step, and right now we're in the process of spinning down the star to match the Proxima Centauri rotation period. And we want to repeat the same exercise and look at how the corona of the Proxima Centauri might look like, and use that information to drive a space weather model in the next year or so. And only after that, we can have some sort of predictions about if we'll find a colony sitting on the Proxima Centauri or not when the breakthrough initiatives, microsatellites, eventually reach there after a few decades. Thank you. So the property we match is everything, all the stellar properties except the rotation period. So everything else is similar to a Proxima Centauri, but we just spin it by 10 days instead of 80 days.
So same mass.
Same mass, everything else is same, yeah.
And the stars with the strong dipole field, does the field reverse on some time scale?
That's one of the things which we think is really different in these stars, is that they don't. So far, all the observations which we have for these young M stars, the dipole doesn't seem to do much. It stays like that. And in these simulations, I have the same thing. It doesn't flip like sun. So that's one of the other properties which is consistent with observations here.
Hi. So thanks for inviting me up the road a little bit. I am brand new at MIT, as you were just told. Sorry, I'm messing with a USB up here. Not going to happen. We'll make without. So I just started at MIT, and this is actually, I've been there since about August, and this is my first time down the road, so thank you for giving me an excuse to come all the way out to CFA. If you ever want to talk to me, I actually am going to be around most of the rest of this afternoon, later in the afternoon, and if you ever want to find me, I actually hide in the Nuclear and Particle Physics Division at MIT, so just look me up. I swear it's not that far from the Kavli Center. All right, so what I'm going to be talking about is what New Star has to say about the galactic center. So, I have to use this. So I'm going to start out by introducing a little bit about the New Star performance, and in particular what's important for galactic center physics, or why I think New Star is such a special instrument to look at the galactic center with. The Galactic Center program has been part of the New Star Science program since before the launch. So really it covers a huge amount of different science that I cannot talk all about right now. So I'm really going to focus in on just kind of one story. And that story is what New Star seems to be telling us that's a little different about how stellar remnant populations vary as you look at different distance scales away from the galactic center. So we're going to look at the very inner, about 10 parsecs, then zoom out and look at 100 parsecs, and then look out maybe at kiloparsec scales, and ask the question, how is the dominant underlying X-ray source population changing maybe as you go between these different regions? Then I'm going to switch into my particle physics hat for just like two slides, and I'm going to talk about how we can use basically these same exact data sets to actually do dark matter particle physics, and in particular sterile neutrino searches. Okay, so I'm assuming a little bit most people have heard of New Star before. New Star is the Nuclear Spectroscopic Telescope Array. It's been in orbit since 2012 and taking data beautifully. When it comes to galactic center science, there's really two important performance characteristics. The first is here on the left. So this is the effective area as a function of energy. New Star is shown in orange, and you can see that New Star expands the effective energy of previous focusing X-ray satellites all the way up to 79 keV. The second point is the angular resolution. So of course, we don't have the exquisite angular resolution of some of these soft X-ray telescopes, but we do pretty well. And so our angular resolution, in particular the PSF of 18 arc seconds, if we think about the galactic center, that's less than a parsec. So we really have sub-parsec angular resolution when we look at the galactic center. Our field of view of 12 arc minutes by 12 arc minutes, again at the galactic center, that's about 30 parsecs by 30 parsecs. So we can take fairly good, fairly high resolution snapshots of the very center of the galaxy. And the galactic center is a really good use of all this for this reason. If you look at the previous high energy X-ray view of the galactic center, that's up there on the top left. So that's the integral 20 to 40 keV image of the central about 1.5 degree by 2 degrees. So this is the central hundreds of parsecs. And you can see what the New Star Galactic Center survey program did is with about 2 megaseconds, we really zoomed in to that blue square, which for integral was just a couple blobs. And we were able to zoom into the central about 0.6 degrees by 1.2 degrees and actually resolve out the structure that lives inside those blobs. So we're able to look at the Sagittarius A complex. Of course, inside there is the supermassive black hole Sagittarius A star. Though what you're really seeing in this image is the very bright emission of the surrounding supernova remnant Sagittarius A east. Heading off along the plane of couple dozen parsecs away, there's a molecular cloud region, there's a star-forming region, and you can already make out in this image a few isolated point sources. So this is what New Star sees. Now, like I said, this is my one snapshot PR slide. There's a lot of science that has come out of just this image that I'm not going to have a chance to talk about. In particular, we've been able to look at flaring from Sagittarius A star itself. Let's see if I manage to make this work. Ooh, it works even if my USB isn't plugged in. So we've been able to observe flaring coming from the supermassive black hole Sagittarius A star, and also observe what we believe are the reverberations of very old, very large X-ray flares in the nearby molecular cloud region. We've been able to look at several supernova remnant molecular cloud interaction sites, and we've also been able to see several new bright X-ray transients happening within just a few parsecs of Sagittarius A star itself. Perhaps the most famous of these is shown in this image. It's so bright that it's overtaking Sagittarius A star itself. This is the magnetar that went off in about 2013 and has only recently started to really sort of dim. Okay, but that's not the story I want to tell. The story I want to talk about is more the question of what is this underlying point source population. So what's most of this stuff when we look in the galactic center? And this question, you know, what is the dominant X-ray point source population, has been studied by basically every single X-ray telescope that's been built. So what I'm showing here are just two images. So this is the RXTE image in black and white. It's the central about 160 degrees, so many, many kiloparsecs along the plane. What you see in the circles, those are, you know, identified bright X-ray sources. What I'm interested in is what's underneath there. So what's all the diffuse emission that lies underneath this so-called galactic ridge X-ray emission? As you can see in the other image, this diffuse emission extends up to fairly high energies. So here's the integral image in 17 to 60 keV. And again, you're kind of squinting at these isolated sources, but you see underneath it, there's still this diffuse emission that extends up to rather high energies. You can also look in low energies. And so what we've done here is if you zoom into the central, this is about 0.8 degrees by 2 degrees, so the central 100 parsecs or so now we're looking at. And this region has been studied extensively by both Chandra and XMM Newton. So we know that Chandra resolved, you know, thousands and thousands of point sources in this region. In addition, XMM Newton and Chandra both were able to look at the diffuse emission that underlies those unidentified point sources. And what was coming out of all of these studies, both the galactic ridge studies as well as sort of the galactic center studies, was kind of this coherent picture that kind of said, wherever we look, we basically think we're seeing a dominant population of unresolved magnetically accreting white dwarfs or magnetic CVs, in particular intermediate polars. And the important point here is the mass. So the average white dwarf mass for basically everywhere people seem to look seemed to be about a half a solar mass. So that's the number to keep in mind. All right, so now what did New Star see? So New Star, just to give a sense of scale, here's where our galactic center survey sits. So again, we're looking at the central 0.6 degrees by 1.2 degrees. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start out by zooming in here to the central very few parsecs. So this is the central about 10 parsecs. I'm going to say, what does New Star tell us that's interesting there that other people haven't been able to see? Okay, so here is the central, this is about 10 parsecs by 10 parsecs. On the left here, this is the New Star 3 to 79 keV, so full energy band image. And on the right, here's the Chandra image. And what you notice is, well, it looks like we basically see the same thing. Okay, so we see a very brightest emission happens right near the supermassive black hole Sagittarius A star. Though that bright emission isn't really coming from the supermassive black hole itself, we know from Chandra that it's actually mostly due to a very close, about 8 arcseconds away, so much less than a parsec away, very close pulsar wind nebula that's very, very bright in X-rays. Surrounding it is this shell of the supernova remnant Sagittarius A east. Heading up to the northwest, you have the plume of the supernova remnant. There's some identified non-thermal filaments. But in general, the morphology is pretty similar. This is not that surprising, right? You expect our 3 to 79 image to be mostly dominated by soft X-rays, so it should look mostly like what Chandra saw. Okay, so really what we want to do then is look at higher energies or start to look in sort of fine energy bins and see how things maybe change. So the first energy bin is, again, just low energy, so this should look very similar to what you just saw. So this is the inner 10 parsecs in 3 to 10 keV with New Star. Different color scheme, but the same idea. You have brightest emission coming from this pulsar wind nebula that's very close to the supermassive black hole. You see some red emission that's filling up the shell of supernova remnant Sag A east. You can kind of pick out there's some emission coming from this neutron star candidate. There's a non-thermal filament up here. There's another one all the way down here. But of course, what you really want to keep in mind is what we're squinting at with New Star. What we're squinting at with New Star is what we know from Chandra is, in fact, thousands and thousands of X-ray identified point sources that sit in this region. So keep in mind, with New Star, we're squinting at that, and it's filling our whole region. Okay, so that's low energy. Now what happens when we look up at high energy? So this is where New Star comes in and New Star is special. So we're able to look now up at 20 to 40 keV. And our picture gets a lot simpler. So one thing that gets simplified is Sag A east basically dies off. So that thermal emission coming from Sagittarius East is gone, and we're able to look for the first time at what's happening underneath that emission, so behind Sagittarius East. And you can see we still have really bright emission from that pulsar wind nebula. That's not going away. And you still kind of see some stuff from this non-thermal remnant and some stuff from this neutron star candidate. But what I want you to do is kind of squint at this light blue stuff. So this light blue stuff is what's new. It's some unresolved, high energy, so greater than 20 keV, X-ray emission that seems to be extending along the galactic plane. If you do 2D spatial fitting to this, it has a spatial dimensions of about 4 parsecs by 8 parsecs, full width half max. So the question here is, well, what's this? And I do want to emphasize, this is not something you can really see in soft X-rays because this supernova remnant is so bright and because there's so many points, bright, soft point sources around. Okay. So if we want to ask what this is, of course, you want to look at the image. You also want to look at the spectrum. So what we did is we took two spectra from two different sides. We basically said we want to be really far away from this bright stuff. So let me take a spectrum from up here, and let me take another spectrum from down here. And what's nice about these two regions is at low energy, they have different contributions. So up here in the north, you get a lot of emission from Sagittarius East when you're at low energies. Down here, you mostly just get unresolved point sources. But the high energy stuff, the question is the high energy stuff the same? So that's what we did. And we took, as our low energy spectrum, just to get better energy resolution, we took the low energy spectrum from XMM. So this is flux as a function of energy. Our low energy spectrum comes from XMM. And you can see that, yes, you do have different spectral components. Basically, it's hard to see with the little dotted lines. But at low energy, our spectral models are different, but basically match what you expect to see from XMM. But here at high energy, up above 10 keV, you have this new component. So what you get from doing this sort of combined spectral fitting is you see the low energy spectra, as well as the luminosity to mass ratio, completely consistent with what XMM Newton and Chandra saw. Basically, XMM Newton and Chandra predict your spectrum should die off somewhere around here. But there's something new, and that something new fits to either non-thermal with a power law index of about 1.6, or thermal and fairly hot and fairly poorly constrained, about 60 keV or at least greater than 36 keV at 90% confidence interval. So, and the other point is that this is the same in both regions. So we do think we're seeing the same population on both sides. So now the question is, okay, what's going on? This seems to be significantly harder than the surrounding regions. We see it kind of constrained to the galactic center. What could it be? So, of course, when we think about what it could be, we need to match it to both the image we have and the spectra we have. But also really highly constraining is we need to match it to radio observations, as well as transient limits from SWIFT. So SWIFT has been looking at this region for well over a decade and monitoring for bright outburst. So if it's going to be something that gives you bright outburst, you need to match it to whether SWIFT saw it or didn't see it. And what that leaves us with are four possibilities, each with its own kind of difficulty, I'll call it. So let's just look at them. So maybe the most sort of intuitive one is everyone else thinks they're seeing magnetic CVs. Maybe you're just seeing a bunch of magnetic CVs, in particular intermediate polars. The interesting thing about that, though, is the white dwarf mass here would have to be almost double what people see in the surrounding regions. So if this is what's going on, it raises questions like, why is it so heavy there? Are you seeing increased binarity, more likely to make a binary? Are you seeing these binaries actually, because there's so much stuff in the galactic center, become more massive through accretion? Are you seeing effects like dynamical friction, where the heaviest stuff is just piling up in the center? I'll come back to that in a moment. Another possibility is that you could have black hole low-mass X-ray binaries. The difficulty with this is if you look at how many you would need to make up the luminosity we see, the question becomes, well, why don't you see these in outbursts? Or why don't you see more in outbursts than we have? And so you have to assume that this would be a population that has either very faint or very long recurrence time outbursts. So again, it would have to be something a little different in the galactic center than we see elsewhere. A third possibility that's very popular with the dark matter Fermi crowd is it could be millisecond pulsars. The difficulty with this is you need even more millisecond pulsars than you would black holes. And again, you have to figure out how you would hide that many in that smaller region and not have found more already. And then the last possibility is that what you're really looking at is particle outflows coming from Sagittarius A star. We know Sagittarius A star goes into outburst. We know it had really big outbursts in the past. Maybe these are particle outflows interacting with the dense molecular material in that region. The problem there is there's no correlation with sort of radio and density, radiation density models, so it gets a little more difficult. So really we're left thinking, hey, we're squinting at some big population of stellar remnants that's in the center. And this is where the NASA press office comes handy, because when I talk about this, I go, some massive unresolved population of stellar remnants in the galactic center. And the NASA press office calls it New Star Captures Possible Screams from Zombie Stars, which is like brilliant, actually, because they are zombie stars. They're accreting binary systems. You have a dead star, and it's feeding off of a living star. That one got a lot of clicks, but that's why they get paid and not me. Okay, so let me go back to sort of maybe the more vanilla explanation, which is that maybe we're seeing a bunch of intermediate pulsars, and they're just heavier than other people thought. So let's look at a model of intermediate pulsars. So intermediate pulsars are white dwarfs. They're accreting material along magnetic field lines onto their poles, and that material gets heated to a temperature that scales with the white dwarf mass. So the hottest temperature happens at the standoff shock region, and the cooler temperature happens below there as it cools towards the white dwarf surface. So this hottest temperature is really what you're seeing with hard X-rays, and these cooler temperatures peak in the emissivity at lower energies. So the question then is, well, maybe the soft X-rays and the hard X-rays are really seeing the same thing, just sort of one's looking at the trunk of the elephant and one's looking at the tail. So what we did is we compared this, you know, inner few parsec spectrum with the Chandra and XMM Newton spectrums of the surrounding 50 parsecs. So not exactly the same region, because remember Sag A East kind of blocks the soft stuff really close in, but the surrounding about 50 to 100 parsecs. And then we compared that with hard X-ray or broadband observations of nearby intermediate pulsars, where we think, you know, they're isolated, we can study them one by one, we can understand what their spectrum looks like. And what we saw is that this model, this idea, seems to work. If you look only at soft X-rays, you can think you're seeing something much lighter than if you look at combined soft and hard X-rays. So everything we saw became consistent in that inner 50 parsecs with a white dwarf population that's just heavier than other people saw, so something around 0.9 m-solar. This is comforting news, because that same mass matches with the SDSS survey average white dwarf mass that they observe. So that feels warm and fuzzy. The problem is the galactic ridge, if you zoom out further, has been studied in broadband X-rays. And they see something that looks a lot more like 0.5 m-solar. So what's happening? And is there some region, some transition region, where these two populations change? So let's zoom out real quick to the inner 100 parsecs now with New Star. So this is where we did the New Star point source survey. We had about 70 identified point sources in this survey region. That's the good news. The bad news is, with the data we have right now, these sources were a little too faint to really do individual spectral analysis and say what is each and every one of these point sources. But instead, what we can do is sort of population studies. So you can look at the log n log s plot of these sources, and that's what we did. So on the y-axis, this is the number of sources per arc minute squared. On the x-axis is the photon flux in 10 to 40, so in hard x-rays. The black, the red, and the blue are the New Star data. So the New Star measured, the only difference between them are slightly different selection criteria for which one you throw into your population. Then what's interesting is here, in the green and the magenta, this is if you take the Chandra sources in those same regions and you extrapolate their flux, assuming some hard x-ray spectrum. And what you can see is you can explain both the Chandra sources and the New Star sources in the same region, which should have the same underlying population. They can all be consistent if that population has either a gamma somewhere between 1 and 2, or a temperature somewhere between 20 and 50. This is, again, good news. This kind of temperature is consistent with a white dwarf mass, like we thought we saw, of about 0.8 m solar. Also, we have iron lines there, so all this is sort of seeming like it kind of ties up into a nice story of these are mostly magnetic CVs, and they have a mass that's around 0.8, 0.9 m solar. Okay, that's kind of good news and bad news, because now what happens when we look further out? So when we look further out with new star, things get fun. So when you really want to study the galactic ridge, you want to look at the inner thousands of parsecs, or several kiloparsecs. And with new star, if you'll remember, I said the field of view is about 30 parsecs by 30 parsecs. So if you're going to use new star the way we intended to do it, this actually becomes a very hard measurement to do. Or you could use new star in a way it was not intended to be used. So what's shown here is sort of a cartoon of new star. If you look in focused photons, that's that small field of view, about 0.05 degrees squared. And that is the field of view for things to go through our optics and be focused down onto our detector. We have a really long focal length, though. So what you can do instead is look for photons that basically just bypass the optics and come and hit your detector all on its own. So you basically just use new star like a detector pointing out at space. What you do, what you get when you do that is for the same observations that I was showing before, you get a sky coverage that's something like this. So these two Pac-Man shapes come from the fact that new star is two co-aligned optics. So we have two of these. Each one covers a slightly different part of the sky. We call these zero bounce photons because they're not bouncing off anything in our focusing optics at all. And you see that we get a really huge sky coverage, which means if you throw away spatial information and all you know is it happening, your photons are coming from somewhere in here, you now get a lot of sky coverage. So what do we see when we look at that? This is still very preliminary, but essentially, we have a spectrum that's consistent with everything everyone else saw. Yay. Good news and bad news. Again, this suggests an average white dwarf mass of 0.5 m solar. So either we have some transition region where we're going from these heavier things to these lighter things, or perhaps we're seeing the population fraction change a bit. So maybe we still have these heavier white dwarfs, these 0.9 that we think we see in the center, and they just happen to be mixed with an increasing fraction of lighter or softer objects like pulsars or dwarf nebulae. And this is an idea that seems to be supported by some other recent studies of the galactic ridge X-ray emission. Okay, so a couple last words on other fun things you can do with this data set. So this is now me switching into my other life and talking about dark matter. So as we know, the galaxy is embedded in a halo of dark matter. The highest density is at the galactic center. So if there's a way for dark matter to produce X-rays, then galactic center observations should be a really leading way to either make constraints on those models or maybe even an observation, if you're very optimistic. So what is a dark matter model that could give you X-rays? One of the leading dark matter models that can give you X-rays are so-called sterile neutrinos. So sterile neutrinos are sort of the cousin of your standard run-of-the-mill neutrino. And they could have a component of warm dark matter if their mass is in the KeV range. So if mc squared is somewhere in the KeV range. What's nice about sterile neutrinos for X-ray searches is this decay diagram. What that decay diagram basically says is there is a finite, small but finite probability for them to decay into a regular neutrino and a photon, and that photon would have half the energy of the sterile neutrino. So if we're talking about KeV scale sterile neutrinos, you're talking about photons that are KeV scale, so X-rays. So what do? Essentially, you take your spectrum, which is what I had before, and you look for a line. So it's a nice, easy search to do. You just say, do I see some line that's not consistent with my spectrum? The height of that line depends on basically the probability for this process to happen. And so you can start to make constraints on sterile neutrinos that way. So this is a well-known process and well-studied by other X-ray instruments. Here is just a quick look at what we did with the galactic center data for this kind of search. Basically, this is the mixing angle, or basically the probability for that decay to happen as a function of sterile neutrino mass. Here in the sort of blue, the yellow, the green, and the purple, these are previous X-ray instruments who have done the same thing, looking at various targets. In red, then, is our new constraint. So if you want your sterile neutrinos to be what's called a minimal supersymmetric standard model, or just sort of your very run-of-the-mill sterile neutrinos, you want it to live somewhere in here. And NuSTAR is starting to basically cut that available space in half. And so we basically have leading constraints from this galactic center data set now in a mass range 10 to 50 keV. And I can note that NuSTAR is also being used for similar constraints coming from the bullet cluster, as well as just extragalactic observations. So that is where I will end it. Just wanted to sum up. So NuSTAR provides a view of the galactic center region with really unprecedented angular resolution in terms of hard X-rays. The X-ray source population appears to be dominated by magnetically accreting white dwarfs, or you could say zombie stars, which I do prefer. And if you are at all interested in sort of NuSTAR and dark matter, sterile neutrinos are not the only things we can do. Also very good for solar axions as well as axion-like particle measurements. Feel free to come talk to me about that. We're actually starting a NuSTAR group dedicated to these dark matter signatures in about a half an hour. That's it.
People tried stacking the signal from those 70 roughly sources to see if they get something aligned or anything?
Yes. So we basically did stack the sources. And you get a spectrum that's consistent with what other people saw in that region. The problem is that they're very weak, so even stacked is not a great spectrum. But there is follow-up work ongoing, essentially within the month.
About the dark matter, sir.
Yeah.
Since you're using zero bounce photons, you are not actually observing the galactic center per se. You're slightly off. I guess galactic center is too bright, maybe too bright. But when you go higher energy, let's say 40 to 80 keV or something, then you may be able to do it by using the two bounce photons. Have you guys tried it?
Yeah, so basically, Jizzle was pointing out that when we use the zero bounce photons, we miss the actual very galactic center. And that's actually good for most of the mass range because it's so bright there in regular stuff. You want it to be kind of dim in regular stuff. But the question was, if you look in high energies at the very center, maybe we can use the two bounce photons to get constraints. The answer to that is, actually, they wouldn't beat the constraints that we already get just from using the zero bounce spectrum. And that comes just from the fact that we're integrating over so much dark matter here that when you look at a very small field of view, you're integrating over very little dark matter, and so your expected signal strength is just low. So your constraints don't become very good.
It's a small effect, it's that you're using APEC through the pits. Have you considered including electron-electron brepstrahlung radiation when you're worried about the higher mass CVs?
So when we get, I don't think this answers your question, but we can talk more about it later, but I know that when we actually derive a mass, meaning like what does our 0.9 come from, we don't use an APEC model at all. We use the full 1D accretion flow IP mass model.
Okay, which may or may not include electron-electron.
Yes.
Any other questions?
You have a large number of CVs, and you probably essentially know what the accretion rate is based on the total luminosity. Does that tell you anything about the number of novae you should be seeing?
So that is a good question. So the question is, we think we know kind of what the accretion rate of the CVs are, and we think we know kind of how many CVs we have, and so can we back out how many dwarf novae we expect to see in these regions?
Real
novae. I have not thought about that very much, but I would be a little worried that just from playing around with the luminosity functions of these, that the luminosity functions have such big uncertainties that we might not be able to say anything super constraining, but I could look at it.
If there's no more questions, let's thank all our speakers today.